Hey, what's up guys? Jeremy here. Welcome to this third module of the RoboDK Professional Training. In this module, we will touch on the basics of pick and place applications. Pick and place or material handling is a very common use case for robot arms in the industry. You can think about palletizing, machine tending, assembly, inspection, and many other. In this module, we will see exactly what we can simulate and how to do it. Let's get started. We will start today by looking at the project we will build together, and then we will look at more advanced stations to see exactly what you can achieve with the different pick and place features of RoboDK. So here's our station. We have a UR robot, we have a vacuum gripper, we have a bunch of little boxes of different colors, and we have some kind of tray or array in which we can hold the parts in place and organize them according to different colors. So the final project should look a bit like that. We pick the different boxes of different colors, place them in the designated area, and we start with the light colored box, and then we put the darker colored box on top of the first ones. So that should look a bit like that. If I show you here the path that we are trying to achieve, you can see here all the robot motions, and if I relaunch it, everything kind of reset at the initial position and the program runs again. So this is what we'll build. Let's take a look at other stations. So we already took a look at this station in module one. So this is a station from one of our partners, so DIY Robotics. The goal here is to assemble old school Game Boys, but an assembly process is pretty much I'm gonna reduce the speed here just a bit, but an assembly process is pretty much a bunch of pick and place applications bundled together. So in this case here, we use three different tools on our robot. So a suction cup to go get the sub-assembly here, we place it in a two-finger gripper type holder here in the middle. Then we bring the back plane, place it in place. Then we go pick with the screwdriver and the screw feeder for screws that we place in the different holes for that at that effect. And then we pick a battery pack, we pick a back door, and then we place it, or battery door. And then we assemble all of that here onto the main assembly. And we pick all of that with the two finger gripper and place it on the out conveyor. So here you can see I'm picking the screws one by one. You can even see here the little feeder bringing in a new screw. And once the four screws are in place, I will go pick with the suction cups a battery pack that I will assemble in place, and then do the same with a battery door. And then the two finger gripper will kind of grab all of it here. And honestly, in this case here, I should rotate my Game Boy to kind of drop them here towards the end so I can avoid the inevitable, in this case, collision between the two finger gripper and the actual conveyor. So that's an example of what you can do here. You can see we have part feeder, we have conveyors and everything. So we won't talk about part feeder conveyors in this module, but we will do in the next one, in module four. You can think about pick and place in a more advanced way. So here I can go for a palletizing application where I have a bunch of box coming in and I need to place them on a pallet according to a given layout, so I can increase the speed of the simulation a bit. So in this case here, I will have a first layout for the first layer where I have two boxes in this direction and then three boxes in the other direction. And then I will do the other layer with an alternate layout. So the two boxes, horizontal or vertical boxes, will be at the end here, and the three horizontal one, if I can name them horizontal or vertical boxes, will be here in front. So by the way, if you feel like you're not seeing much here in the station tree, I do agree that it could be a bit clearer, and I will show you in a future video a way to have that here opaque so that you're not like having to differentiate between what's written here in the in the station tree and the 3D elements that you have behind. So I generally always use that opaque background. So I'll show you how to do that later. But as this is the default behavior of RoboDK, I prefer creating this training using the transparent background, even if it's not what I'm using personally. Okay, so this is it. You can even complexify stuff even more and add a add an external axis and a box bounder. So in the other example, all the boxes were part of the station when we begin. So the conveyor was simply bringing the boxes one by one, or moving all the boxes forward. Here we really have a box bounder where a new box will appear out of nowhere and put it on the conveyor to be placed by the robot onto the pallet. And in this case here, we have an external axis. So in between the layers, the external axis will move up so that we are always within reach. So that's another level of complexity. We will talk about external axis in a future module, but here I wanted to show you exactly what we were able to do. And then I can go even one step further and use a pick and place application to feed box onto a conveyor, in boxes onto a conveyor. So if I run my main here, I pick a box here on a small conveyor and I'm placing it according to a given layout into another box, just like that here. And once that box is full with two layers of boxes in it, it will move forward to bring in a new empty box. So that's the kind of thing you can easily do with RoboDK if you want to do some pick and place project. I will show you tricks on how to do that, but obviously we won't start with something as complex as that. We will start by simply moving a cube around. And as I already said or mentioned, at the end of this module, you should be able to do the first box organization program I showed you, where I was kind of classifying little cubes by color. So this would be your objective by the end of this module. So I hope we will tag along and follow these step by step. I'm pretty sure it will be super useful for your personal project. As usual, I'm building up small information on top of small information, small knowledge on top of small knowledge. But at the end of the day, if you follow all of those training carefully, you will know as much as I do about RoboDK, and I can tell you that we can do a lot of stuff with that software. That being said, have a great day, guys.